Hi everybody, welcome back to Busch History. I am David Busch. I'm presenting a series of videos on the presidents of the United States. This is a companion series to my website, www.bushhistory.net, and to my extensive series on American history. There are a series of timeline reviews as well as many topic discussions on this website. I suggest you take a look if you would like more in-depth information. These videos are snapshots, summaries, if you like, of the events during each of the presidents. They're a good review and a good form of reference. So with that in mind, let's take a look at Dwight Eisenhower here. Dwight Eisenhower, 34th president of the United States. And Dwight Eisenhower, this is the hero of D-Day. This is the gentleman who was the architect of the plan to end World War II in Europe. And he's going to become president of the United States during the most of the 1950s. Let's take a close look at him. President Dwight Eisenhower, number 35, Vice President Richard Nixon. His political party was, he was a Republican. His term of office, 1953 to 1961. Who came before him and after him? What were their political parties? Harry Truman preceded him as a Democrat, and John Kennedy followed him also as a Democrat. Any unusual circumstances surrounding his ascent to the presidency? Well, Truman was thought to have mishandled things in Korea, according to Eisenhower. He chose to run as a Republican because he was unhappy with the way the Democrats had handled foreign policy, and particularly the Korean War in the 1950s. Any catchphrase or term specifically associated with him? Eisenhower was a likable guy. Everybody loved him. So his nickname was Ike, and I Like Ike became a slogan. It was on buttons, his campaign buttons, when he was running for president. A quote of his was a military-industrial complex. It was actually during the last speech of his administration in 1961, and he warned against intrusion of military and defense industries in the United States into policies, into foreign policy in the United States. He thought that the relationship between the manufacturers of weapons and the military was a bad relationship. Because what do the munitions manufacturers want? They want wars to sell their products. What does the military want? They want new weapons to fight those wars. And the two of them together could end up getting us into some very bad situation. And you know what? I think he was kind of right. Anyway, another quote of his specifically was, the U.S. never lost a soldier or a foot of ground during my administration. And he could tout that. He could tout that he had a relatively peaceful administration in terms of foreign policy. Yes, there were foreign policy issues, but we were not involved in wars during his administration. When he left office, was it by choice, defeat, natural death, assassination, resignation, etc.? He simply retired after his two terms in 1961. And that was the end of Eisenhower as president. Domestic issues and events. One of the interesting things, as a Republican president, you'd be surprised to know that he had a 92% marginal tax rate while he was president, and throughout his entire administration, it was a 92% marginal tax rate. Yes, left over from World War II and the New Deal, no doubt. Now understand that marginal tax rate, that 92%, is not on your entire income, it's on the top most portion of your income. Might be the last $2,000 or $3,000, or the last $10,000 if you're making a ton of money. It's not on your entire income. So people throw that number around and you think, wow, 92% of my income is being taxed. Not true. A small portion of your income is being taxed at a very high rate, no doubt about it. But while that was occurring, we financed the GI Bill. We financed national highways being built in the United States. We financed the beginning of NASA. We ended the Korean War. We actually had a pretty good period of prosperity during the 1950s with a high tax rate. Anyway, 1954, certainly we have Brown versus the Board of Education, landmark civil rights case calling for the end of segregation in schools. And in 1955, we actually have something called Little Brown, which was forced integration based on the Brown case. We have Joe McCarthy in 1954. He was censured, which simply means he could no longer speak in the Senate after the whole McCarthyism fiasco. 1955, we have the famous Rosa Parks story, in which she refused to give up her seat on the bus, and that led to the Montgomery bus boycott. Just a little point about Rosa Parks, people sometimes confuse this. Rosa Parks had actually been a member of the NAACP. She was a secretary the NAACP, and people who were involved in the NAACP had been briefed about how to be activists in given situations. So Rosa Parks was not just your average person sitting on the bus, and sometimes it's portrayed that way. She knew what she was getting into. She was still a pioneer. She was still very brave, but it wasn't just somebody's mother or somebody's aunt. And we got to make sure we had to get that point. And that led to the Montgomery bus boycott. The idea is, well, if they don't want to integrate the buses, well, hit them where it hurts. We won't ride the buses. And economically, it'll hurt them an awful lot. In 1956, we get the Interstate Highway Act, part of that 92% marginal tax rate, where Eisenhower realizes that if we're ever invaded, we need to be able to move our weapons and our troops very, very quickly. But how do we convince the public that we need to build these super highways? Well, let's make sure the public can use them as well. So these highways were built with the idea of moving troops and moving weapons very quickly, but they also had a civilian application. So it was a nice dual use idea, and that's the Interstate Highway Act of 1956. In 1957, Eisenhower has a showdown with Governor Orville Faubus in Little Rock, Arkansas. A governor of Arkansas over Central High School in Little Rock. And that had to do with the Little Rock Nine and integration of Central High School and these nine students being allowed to enter. Governor Faubus resisted. President Eisenhower says, you're not going to resist this. And President Eisenhower actually wins. It's a long standoff. But then what they do the next year is they close the schools in Little Rock. So they actually lost, won, and then lost again. In 1958, we have NASA. NASA occurs as a result of Sputnik in the Soviet Union. And then in 1960, we have the Civil Rights Act, the first of many civil rights events during the 1960s. And that issued federal sanctions against officials obstructing voting in the United States. We have the Greensboro sit-in at that Woolworth's lunch counter. For those who don't know what Woolworth's is anymore, think Kmart, think Kohl's with a lunch counter. It was a very similar kind of store to Kmart with a lunch counter. In fact, Kmarts have lunch counters today. Now, who knows? If you're watching this video in years to come, maybe they won't be Kmarts anymore, or they might have changed the way they are, but that's a good way to think about them. And if you click here, it's Eisenhower's ideas on taxes and budgets. And if you click here, you get Eisenhower speaking about the military-industrial complex. Foreign policy under Ike. It was a busy decade, no doubt. In 1953, we have the Korean War ceasefire. It is important to understand there is no peace treaty for the end of the Korean War. The Korean War is technically not over. If the war was over, you would not have a DMZ, a demilitarized zone, separating North Korea and South Korea. And you wouldn't have troops on both sides. And you wouldn't have all kinds of wrangling between the North and the South. This is simply a ceasefire. Stalin dies in 1953. And leaves the Soviet Union without a leader for several years. We have the Pact of Madrid, which is a trade deal with Generalissimo Franco. Francisco Franco was the dictator of Spain. And the Shah is installed in Iran. We helped overthrow a democratically elected government in Iran, and we installed the Shah. And that is part of NSC 68. And this came back to bite us in the butt in 1979 with the overthrow of the Shah. We installed him, and what we got was a puppet regime in Iran, and we got cheap oil for a very long time. But in 1979 through 1980 and then into 1981, we have the Iranian Revolution where the Ayatollah comes to power. We're going to have the hostage crisis in there. Wasn't a good idea. 1954, we have a division of Vietnam after the Battle of Dien Bien Phu, in which the French were defeated. And we're going to have the continuum of the containment policy, not allowing communism to spread. Operation Wetback, which is a terrible name, but it had to do with controlling illegal immigrants coming across the border into Texas in the United States. And we have the Guatemalan coup, in which the NSC supported an overthrow of the Guatemalan government for an American-friendly government. In 1955, we have CETO, the Southeast Asia Treaty Organization, which gets us involved in a defensive pact in Southeast Asia, very similar to NATO, with the idea that we will help defend Southeast Asia if they're attacked as a result of trying to defend themselves against communists. We also send the first U.S. soldiers into Vietnam in 1955. Now, I want you to think about that. Our soldiers actually go in 1955. Vietnam ultimately falls in 1975, and the last American soldiers come out in 1975. So we're in Vietnam for 20 years. We tend to think about Vietnam as a 1960s war, and yes, that is the height of the war. There's no doubt about it. But we had soldiers in Vietnam in the 1950s. They were advisors, but advisors have a way of getting involved in things. In 1956, we have the Suez Canal crisis. This was who's going to control the Suez Canal, and that involves Israel, Britain, and France against Egypt trying to control the Suez Canal. We have the Hungarian Revolution, which was a revolution against communism in Hungary that we did not get involved in. Eisenhower was criticized for that. In 1957, the Soviets launched Sputnik. And of course, Americans are crazy now. Oh no, they're gonna attack us. They're gonna start dropping bombs from space. And that was what launched NASA in 1958. In 1958, we do commit troops in Lebanon to help prop up the government in Lebanon. In 1959, we have Castro coming to power in Cuba. And then we have the St. Lawrence Seaway being opened as a joint venture between the United States and Canada. In 1960, right around the time President Eisenhower said, we don't do this stuff, Gary Powers is shot down over the USSR flying a spy plane. This is right before Khrushchev was coming to visit, and Eisenhower was saying, we don't spy on the Soviet Union, and we were spying on the Soviet Union. Then what they did is they marched Gary Powers on TV in front of everyone to see, oh, I guess you do spy. 1961, we have his farewell address, which I mentioned earlier, which had to do with his military-industrial warning. And I personally think that was a warning that we should have taken a look at many times in the years following his presidency. Nevertheless, Dwight Eisenhower, remarkable president in the 1950s, very influential. We don't talk about him enough these days. But nevertheless, this is Dwight Eisenhower. I'm David Busch. This is Busch History, and we'll see you again. Have a good day.